it is saying, Swami, sorry, for her it is saying that waiting for host to start the meeting.
Again, it starts.
No, for her, when she's trying to log in, she's saying that the message when she's logging into Zoom.
ओम ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति ओम
ओम
ईश्वरो
ईश्वरो
गुरुरात्मेति
मूर्ति भेद विभागिने
व्योमवत्व्याप्तदेहाय
व्योमवत्व्याप्तदेहाय
दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः
दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः
सदाशिवसमारम्भाम्
सदाशिवसमारम्भाम्
शंकराचार्यमध्यमाम्
शंकराचार्यमध्यमाम्
अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम्
अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम्
वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्
वन्दे
गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ सहनावतु
ॐ सहनावतु
सहनौ भुनक्तु
सहनौ
भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै
करवावहै
तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै
तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु
ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
ॐ शान्ति
शान्तिः
ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयम्
ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयम्
व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम्
अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम्
अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वैषिणीम्
अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वैषिणीम्
यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतस्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदै साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैर्गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यै योगिनः यस्यां तन्न विदुःसुरासुरगणा देवाय तस्मै नमः सर्वस्वरूपे सर्वेशे सर्वशक्ति समन्विते भयेभ्यस्त्राहिनो देवी दुर्गे देवी नमोस्तुते रोगानशेषानपहंसि तुष्टारुष्टा तु कामान् सकलानविष्टान् त्वामाश्रितानान्न विपन्नराणां त्वामाश्रिता ह्यश्रयतां प्रयान्ति सर्वा बाधा प्रशमनं त्रैलोक्यस्याखिलेश्वरी एवमेव त्वया कार्यम् अस्मद्वैरि विनाशनम् सर्वस्वरूपे सर्वेशे सर्वशक्ति समन्विते भयेभ्यस्त्राहिनो देवी दुर्गे देवी नमोस्तुते रोगानशेषानपहंसि तुष्टारुष्टा तु कामान् सकलानभीष्टान् त्वामाश्रितान्नान्न विपन्नराणां त्वामाश्रिता ह्यश्रयतां प्रयान्ति सर्वा बाधा प्रशमनं त्रैलोक्यस्याखिलेश्वरी एवमेव त्वया कार्यम् अस्मद्वैरि विनाशनम् सर्वस्वरूपे सर्वेशे सर्वशक्ति समन्विते भयेभ्यस्त्राहिनो देवी दुर्गे देवी नमोस्तुते रोगानशेषानपहंसि तुष्टारुष्टा तु कामान् सकलानभीष्टान् त्वामाश्रितान्नान्न विपन्नराणां त्वामाश्रिता ह्यश्रयतां प्रयान्ति
त्वामाश्रितानां विपन्नराणां त्वामाश्रिता ह्यश्रयतां प्रयान्ति
सर्वा बाधा प्रशमनम् त्रैलोक्यस्याखिलेश्वरी
सर्वा बाधा प्रशमनम् त्रैलोक्यस्याखिलेश्वरी
एवमेव त्वया कार्यम् अस्मद्वैरि विनाशनम्
एवमेव त्वया कार्यम् अस्मद्वैरि विनाशनम्
प्रशांतात्मा विगत भी ब्रह्मचारी प्रतिष्ठितः
प्रशांतात्मा विगत भी
मनस्संयम्य मच्चित्तः युक्त आसीत मत्परः युञ्जन्नेवं सदात्मानं योगी नियतमानसः शान्तिं निर्वाणपरमां मत्संस्थामधिगच्छति नात्यश्ननस्तु योगोऽस्ति न चैकान्तमनश्नतः न चाति स्वप्नशीलस्य जाग्रतो नैव चार्जुन युक्ताहार विहारस्य युक्तचेष्टस्य कर्मसु युक्तस्वप्नावबोधस्य योगो भवति दुःखः We were seeing yesterday 15th verse of Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavan, the main intention in this verse is the phalam of meditation. As a result of contemplation, Bhagavan says, if person does proper meditation, then what will happen? Bhagavan says, adhigacchati. Adhigacchati means the person gains. But what person gains? Then Bhagavan says, shantim. Adhigacchati. The person gains a peace. But which type of shanti? So two adjectives Bhagavan have been used in this verse. Nirvana paramam, another is matsanstham shanti. And which type of person? Then Bhagavan says, niyatamanasaha. A person who is the master of one's own mind. And that person, what that person has to do, Saint Bhagavan says, sada, that person should always atmanam, one's own mind, yunjan, should connect it. He should be connecting one's own mind in contemplation. Then that yogi, means a meditator, one who is the master of one's own mind, that person gains paramam shanti. Paramam means ultimate shanti. And why this is the ultimate? Because of liberation. Nirvana paramam. Nirvana means liberation. And Paramount means ultimate. And Matasanstham, which is centered on me. Sanstham means Tishtati, one who remains, obtained in me. We have seen almost this verse. So evam means that person in this manner, what Bhagwan has described, which asanam, samakaya shira grivam, that all steps a person has to follow means in this manner. Sada means always, atmanam, one's own mind, yunjan means connecting, yogi means meditator. And this meditator is niyatamanasaha. Then shanti. We have seen there are three types of shanti. One shanti we have to gain to use of some medicine. We can use after induce some alcohol. Then we don't have proper thought process. Thought process almost stop. Then person can be have little bit peace. Another shanti, by living a life of karma yoga. And a person who lives a life of karma yoga, then that person can create a distance between oneself and mind. Such person can manage any situation. And because of managing such situation, that person can have shanti. And last one, shanti, we have seen a person, one who is a self-knowledge. And because of knowledge, that person knows, mind is given to me, but I am not mind. Mind is given an instrument to me, but I am not mind. So whatever thought comes in one's own mind, that person's mind, he never affected, because he says, thoughts are belongs to mind and I am not mind. Such person is totally free. In spite of living in this body, this knowledge makes that person free, and such person also gains shanti. And here Bhagwan is discussing this shanti. Means after gaining knowledge, a person who has a shanti, this is called that shanti. And for that shanti only, Bhagwan has given two adjectives. One is mat sansthan, and another is Nirvan Paramam. Yesterday, that Shanti, 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 that Anita ji has asked, that Shanti is common Shanti, which always we are using after each and every Shanti part. That meaning is totally different. And here, the meaning is totally different. So first, Shanti. For this shanti, Bhagwan has used one adjective is mat sansthaam. So sansthaam, the meaning is sam tishthati, properly one who remains. Mat means in me. One, because of one who is living, one who is remaining, obtaining in me, that person gains shanti. And in me, we can take also in two way. In me means as a Parameshwara. Like there are many devotees, their minds in always with Lord Parameshwara, like a Meera, like a Tulasidas, that also gain shanti. In another way we can say Mat, the original nature of Ishwara, that Satyam Jnanam Ananta. Even one who knows the real nature of mind is Satyam Jnanam Anantam, that person also gains same shanti, which is not away from one's own nature. Otherwise, we can say, which is not away from Lord, that Paramam, that Mat Sansthaam Shantim Adhigachati. And that we have seen very beautifully. Such shanti never oppose anything. Whatever come, it never oppose anything. It never opposes any thought process. This type of shanti, Swarupaha Shanti, never opposes the word also. That shanti never opposes jnanam also, even agyanam also. Anything, it doesn't resist, oppose because of this Chaitanya consciousness, everybody can possible, everything can possible. That's why yesterday I have said, in Kena Upanishad, Guru has given Upadesha to students. What is that particular thing? Guru says, it is a vidita avidita abhyam adi. That consciousness is away from even known and unknown. So known means whatever knowledge we have, and unknown also, ignorance. We know I'm ignorant about such somebody's. Something also, some people also, but we know I'm ignorant. So I know I'm ignorant, that I know I have knowledge is common. That is called the Swarupa of one's own. That Shanti is called Mat Sanstham. And another word Bhagavan has used is Nirvana Paramam. Nirvana, Shankaracharya has given the meaning is Nirvana is equal to Moksha, liberation. And the meaning of Parama means Nishta, commitment. One who is totally committed. So means Nishta means commitment. So a person who gains Shanti, which is committed full by gaining liberation, it's called Nirvana Parama. So Nirvanam is equal to Mokshaha. Parama, Shankaracharya says, is equal to Nishta, means commitment. So why that person has got this commitment? So because of this liberation. Because of liberation, that person is totally committed. It's called Shanti. And this Shanti, name Bhagavan has given, Nirvana Parama, ultimate. After having gained this Shanti, person doesn't want any type of Shanti. Because all, like yesterday we were talking, apuryamanam vachala pratishtam samudramapa pravishanti yadvat tadvat kama pravishanti sarve sa shantim prapnoti na kama kami. Means like all waters, it just dissolve, which merge in ocean, then there is no anything need. Same way, all desire, all whatever we want, so ultimate is Chaitanya Tattva. Apuryamanam Machala Pratishtam. Like ocean is always filled without water also, with water also. Same way, consciousness also always Purna. With knowledge, without knowledge, whatever is always Purna. That Shanti we have gained through this knowledge is called Nirvana Parama. So Bhagavan says, such person has got this Nirvana Shanti, Ashanti having gained after liberation. That the disposition of mind is called Nirvana Parama. This is our own Swarupa. That's why Bhagavan says, Nirvana Paramam Shanti. And what yesterday we have seen, almost the same verse Bhagavan has discussed in 18th chapter, 62 verse, what Raviji has said. Bhagavan says, Tameva Sharanam Gaccha Sarva Bhavena Bharata Tat Prasadat Param Shanti Sthanam Prapsyasi Shashvatam. If we totally surrender unto the Lord, then Tat Prasadat, because of that grace, that person will gain, Prapsyasi is a future tense, that person will gain Param Shantim, ultimate Shantim, and even Sthanam also, Shashvatam Sthanam, Prapsyasi. Almost same Baba Bhagavan has discussed here. And one Yogi Shabda, here Bhagavan has used, Shankaracharya has given the meaning, here Yogi is not only a person who is doing Ashtanga Yoga, but here the meaning of Yogi means one who knows oneself, is a Jnani. Otherwise, Paramam Shantim, Nirvana Paramam and Mat Sanstam Shanti, Bhagavan never used this adjective. So here the Niyatamana Sahayogi is considered as a one who has a self-knowledge. So here the meaning of yogi is not simple meditator, but here the meaning of yogi is a person who has a knowledge. What is my real Swarupa? It's called yogi. That Shankaracharya has given minor note. So here the meaning of yogi is the one who has such knowledge, recognition of oneself, not a person who knows Ashtanga Yoga. So yogi is a jnani, not simple meditator. Now again, in next 16th verse, Bhagwan says, a meditator who would like to sit in meditation, they should follow some rules for food, some rules of for sleeping also. So Shankaracharya says, again told here, idanim means now, yoginaha, for such meditator, ahar adi niyamaha uchyate. Bhagavan is going to tell, there are some rules for meditator. Ahar means food, adi means sleep, how much we have to sleep, etc. It's being said in this 16th verse. We have already chanted. So Bhagavan would like to say, main sentence is yogaha na asti. Yogosti na is the main sentence. Yogaha na asti. Meditation cannot possible. There is a no meditation. For whom? So Bhagavan says, na ati ashnataha yogaha nasti. Cha ekantam anashnataha yogaha nasti. Ati sapnashilasya api yogaha nasti. Even jagrataha api yogaha nasti. So ati ashnataha means one who eats a lot. For such person, meditation is not possible. Ekanta anashnataha, one who doesn't eat anything. For such person, yogaha nasti. So yogaha nasti is connected with each and every sentence. 1 minute. Yoga Arjuna, yogaha nasti is the main sentence. For whom? Ati ashnataha yogaha nasti. Nacha ekanta anashnataha yogaha nasti. Nacha ati sapna shilasya yogaha nasti. Nacha eva jagratasya. The meaning of ati ashnataha means too much eating. Na ekanta ashnataha, one who doesn't eat anything. Ati sapna shilasya means one who sleeps a lot. For such person, yoga nasti na eva jagrataha cha. One who is always keep awake, for such person also, yoga nasti. So this verse is basically is not antarag sadhana. Again, Bhagavan has discussed in 16th and 17th verse is bahirang sadhana. We have seen what is the meaning of antarang and bahirang sadhana. Bahirang sadhana means daily what rules we have to follow, and antarang means before meditation, immediately which steps we have to follow. It's called antarang sadhana. So this is about food habit and about sleep habit. So both are daily. That's why it's called bahirang sadhana. So in this verse, Bhagavan has explained whatever the extreme is not good for meditation. Anything is extreme. So Bhagavan has given emphasis on this only. Quantity food. In this Bhagavan has says, quantity food is being explained. One should not have it in bulk. And later in 17th chapter, again Bhagavan will say, which type of food we have to eat. Either which are sattvika, which are rajasika, and which are tamasika. So again, Bhagavan has said here, yoga nasti. This is the main, and the meaning of yoga nasti is there is a no meditation. So yoga means meditation. We can take an meditation as a sagunam ishvarasya dana. Any vigraha we can take, and yoga we can take also nirguna swarupasya dana. We can take any nirguna means brahman satyam jnanam brahma. If we can meditate, Nididhyasanam can also consider as a yoga, while Sagunam Ishwar, any Ishwaras Dhyana, consider as a yoga. So first is Ati Ashnataha. Ashnan, Ashnati is to eat. So Bhagavan says, the main verb is Ash. Ash means to eat. And being in the ninth conjugation, Na is added. So ash means to eat. Bhagavan says, Ati Ashnataha. One who eats a lot, overeating is not good. Overeating can give temporary enjoyment, but ultimate overeating always invite disease. That's why Bhagavan says, Ati Ashnataha. Here I have mentioned Bhashyam. There is some good portion of Bhashyam. Shankaracharya says, what is the meaning of Ati Ashnataha? Ati Ashnataha. More, what is the overeating? So Shankaracharya says, each and every person has their own capacity to eat. It's called Atma Sammitam. We have seen in Sanskritam class, Ma means to measure. Mit means measured. So everybody has Atma Sammitam. Each and every person has their own measured food. One can be satisfied for 4 bread. One can be full their stomach within 2 bread also. So everybody knows how much I have capable. It's called Atma Sammitam. So measured, one's own measured. Anna Parinamam. Parimanam is again the measured food. That atitya, that cross, ashnataha, one who eats, is called atya anashnataha. According to north side, we know our capacity is 4 chapati. But if we eat 6 atitya, it's called atitya. According to our capacity, beyond our capacity, we eat, it's called atitya. That is called atya anashnataha. And Shankaracharya is given, there is a one Shatapatha Brahmana, there is a one book. So he's in that book, there is a one shloka, there is a one verse is given, which food can protect us and which food can destroy us. A very beautiful verse. So it is written, Yadu means Yat, who Atma Sammitam. So according to our capacity, annam, if we take, tad annam, avati, tad avati, tad avati nahi, but that tad avati, that annam can protect us, here avati, tan na hinasti, they never destroy us. But yad bhuyaha, bhuyaha means one who take a lot, yad bhuyaha tat hinasti. It will destroy our body. We can attract many diseases like diabetes, heart problem, anything. Tat yat kaniyaha. If we take little bit food, compared to our measured food, if we take little bit food, tat na avati. Such food cannot protect us. So, according to this Brahmana, the annam is food can protect us also, and that food can never allow to destroy us. If people keep on fasting, then person can die. And if person can keep on eating, that person can also die. That's why he says, annam can avati, protect also, annam can hinasti also, can destroy. How much we have to eat should decided by us only. That's why Shankaracharya says, tasmat, for that reason, yogi means that meditator, na atma sammitat, according to one's own measure, anath adhikam nyunam va na ashniyat, this nakara will come here. So a person who knows how much my capacity, from that capacity, adhikam na ashniyat, one should not eat more also, even nyunam va, even that person should not eat even less or whatever our capacity, that much we have to eat. Athva, what is the meaning of atiyashnata? Again, Shankaracharya says, athva, we can take it as a different way. Athva, there are a yoga shastra. Yoginaha yoga shastre paripatitat. There is yoga shastra, means in Patanjali yoga shastra, it is given how much we have to eat. So that's why he says, yoga shastre paripatitat. What is given in yoga shastra, that anna parima. Somebody says, I don't know how much my capacity, how can I know what is my capacity? If somebody asks, then he says, yoga shastre paripatitat, which is given in yoga shastra, how much one has to eat, anna parimanat, that measured anna, ati matram, in more capacity, ashnataha, one who eats, for such person, yogaha na asti. That person cannot sit in meditation. Somebody says, ask why, you know. It says always, which is the conducive time for meditation, never after food. If we sit after lunch or even heavy breakfast and even dinner, so always we can go to sleep. Comfortably, we can go to sleep. Because stomach is heavy. And if we have eaten too much, then always we are sleepy only. That's why it says, you cannot eat too much annam. And again, Shankaracharya has given one beautiful one shloka. How much we have to eat? There's a good shloka is given. Our stomach, if we take our stomach, so we can divide it into like this. So in this shloka it says, food should be we have to take up to half. One part we have to take for water and another part should be kept free, empty. Vayu sancharanantam. So that saman vayu can move, can digest whatever we have eaten. So this is given here in this shloka. Ardham ashanasya. Ardham ashanasya. What we have taken, the stomach should be full with ardham. And what is ardham? Savyanjanasya. Savyanjanasya means different type of food item. Vyanjana is food item. So how much we have to eat? Ardham. Whatever we have taken food is maybe different type of, maybe rice, sabji, vegetables, whatever is called vyanjana. So that should be ardham. Our trutiyam udakasya cha. That one third part, not one third, but third part is for udakam, means water. Vayoho sancharanartham. Then this fourth part is chaturtham avasheshayat. One fourth we have to keep empty. And for what purpose? He says vayoho sancharant. If we take one pot also, we keep on filling something. Even food item, we keep on filling. Pot is full with food. Then if we would like to mix, how can we mix? Same way, our stomach is like pot also. We keep on feeling. Then when this saman vayu digestion can, how can it possible? That's why it says, fourth part is always keep empty. Third, this part is for water and half stomach is for food. And again Bhagavan says, Nacha ekantam anashnatah. Ekantam anashnatah means one, there are such people who eat a lot, and there are people also who never eat. It's called ekant, one who do not eat too much. I know one person, she is in another cult, she is a sadhu. But she used to take only 2 mangoes per day. Sometimes she takes only 1 coconut water, nothing. It's always, it's called Atma Sammitat. We don't know how much our capacity. But Nacha Ekanta Manashnata. Pujya Swamiji used to tell us, if you don't eat anything, you know, so when you sit in meditation, there starts, some noise will come from inside. I'm hungry, I'm hungry. Even you cannot sit in meditation. So both is not good. Overeating and total not eating. And then Bhagavan says, Nacha ati swapna shilasya. One who sleeps a lot. Swapna shila. Here swapna actually is wrong. Swapna shilasya. One who oversleeps. This is also direct proportion. Who eats a lot, that person sleeps a lot also. Because more we eat, more we feel sleepy. So ati swapna shilasya. One who eats more, for them sleep is also more, and who do not much, and that person, if doctor asks you have to do some exercise, one is taking more food, no? They never do exercise, they're always lazy. And such person cannot sit for meditation. And even it is given, na eva jagratah. Even a person who keeps on waking, that person also cannot sit for meditation. In previous time, it was no electricity. People always live on that lamp. So generally they go to sleep at 9 o'clock. And for such person, they can wake up at 4 o'clock, 4 a.m. Brahma Muran. It is comfortable for them. But nowadays, you know what happened? We always sleep very late. And when we sleep at 12 o'clock, even 1 a.m., 2 a.m., then how can person get up early morning? So when we say, na eva jagratasya, so it says, generally nowadays in metro city, in big city, people sleep very late. And when they wake up, they always wake up also very late. And such person cannot sit. Because jagrataha means late night, one who always awake. It's called awakening, late night. Such person can also cannot sit for meditation. Because we need a quality time, exclusive time when we are totally fresh. There are a person, one person says, I am always fresh after 12. Means 1 a.m., 2 a.m., I am always fresh. Then maybe, I don't know, but that person can sit. Generally, but they say when we wake up, no, at that time we are totally not fresh, but we in midnight we are always fresh. So such person can sit, but in general at that time also our mind is tired, and such mind cannot sleep, cannot sit in. So it says such people awake long in night time and goes to sleep very late. Such person cannot get up early. And when generally gets up, it would be less time to complete all daily the morning work, and there is a no time of meditation. That's why it is not good. So they say, then how can it possible for a person? So that's why Shankaracharya raised the question, katham punaha yoga bhavati? Then how can meditation is possible? So it's iti uchyate. It is being said in 17th verse by Bhagavan only. So Bhagavan says, yukta ahar, yukta viharaha, yukta cheshtasya karmasu, yukta sapna avabodhasya, योगो भवति दुःखः. युक्तः means moderate, is a proper. So Bhagwan says, one who eat properly, moderate, one viharaha, one who does activity properly, karmasu yukta cheshtasya, with reference to karma, one who has proper activity, mindful activity, yukta cheshta. Here the meaning of cheshta means whatever action they undertake with proper understanding is called yukta cheshtasu. Yukta sapna, one who sleep properly. Yukta avabodh, one who wake properly. For such person, yogaha bhavati dukkaha. Here the ha means harati, hinasti. For such person, meditation can destroy that person's sorrow. Dukkham harati, dukkham hinasti. Otherwise, he say ha means hinasti. That pain can destroy one who sit for meditation. But condition is everything in measured, everything in proper, or we can say everything in moderate. No, nothing extreme. So yukta ahar viharasya karmasu yukta cheshtasya yukta svapna avabodhasya yogaha dukkaha bhavati. Dukkaha, here ha means hinasti. Dukkha means pain or sorrow. Not sukhaha. If he written sukhaha, then our happiness will go, destroy. So here dukkaha. So yukta ahar, meaning is yukta ahar also, yukta vihar also. So Shankaracharya has written, what is the meaning of ahara and what is the meaning of vihar? So he says, ahriyate iti ahara. What is taken inside? Ahriyate is called ahara. And what is vihara? So he says, viharanam. When we are moving, padakramaha, we are using our legs for movement. It's called vihara. So whatever we are doing, it should be proper, moderate. So padakramaha, tau yukto. So sometime, here also, you know, I have seen here, I don't know in city also, there are many people, if we ask, where are you going? So okay, nothing, just we are moving. There is no purpose, we are moving. So it's called viharaha, but it's considered as not yukta, ayukta. But if you are going to help someone, if you are going for our job, if you are going something to shopping, everything is a yukta. But without any intention, without any, we keep on moving. Even you have noticed or not noticed, I don't know. But there are a person I have seen in sitting meditation also, they are moving their legs. They cannot sit quietly. Even they are sitting on the chair, their leg is always, you know, moving. Like some doctors, I have noticed. Even while sitting in class also, they are keeping on, they are moving their one leg. Otherwise, one hand is ayukta vihara. Bhagwan says, whatever we are doing, no, we can make out what they are thinking. Something is going, something else. So Bhagwan says, yukta aharaha, yukta vihara. And yukta cheshtasya karmasu. Here karmasu means with reference to Vishaya Saptami. This is seventh case, but Bhagwan says, yukta cheshtasya karmasu. Yukta niyata cheshta yasya karmasu. Yukta means proper. With reference to any activity, one who always think properly, it's called yukta cheshta. So what is the meaning of cheshta, you know? So it is given in even home study also, in another Gita, they like Madhusudan Bhashya, they say the meaning of cheshta means we have undertake one work. Suppose, okay, today I will complete my wardrobe. I will clean my wardrobe. Then they have taken out all whatever inside the wardrobe they have taken out. But while taken out, that person has find out something is very important note. So they have given up all wardrobe, all whatever things outside. In what in note it is written, he starts find out in somewhere else. If he doesn't find out, then he goes to ask someone else. So after 2 hours, he says everything is messed up. It's called, it is not proper chesta. Whatever undertaken, one, it should be complete, then we can take another job. It's called yukta chesta. So with reference to karma, even in job also, we have decided first this work we will complete and then we'll take another one. But first work we complete, half complete, then we take another. It's called, it is not yukta cheshta, but ayukta cheshta. So some Puja Swamiji has written, what is the meaning of yukta cheshta? So it is like Buddha follows Zen people. They always, what they're doing, they do properly. If they are walking, then they say walking meditation. If they are talking, they say talking meditation. If they are eating, then eating meditation. While eating, their focus is only on eating only. It's called yukta cheshta. Whatever I am doing properly. For such person, yoga bhavati dukkha. So if work is not proper, mind is upset, then how yoga bhavati dukkha, how can it possible? That's why. And then Bhagavan says, yukta swapna avabodhasya. Yukta swapna, one who sleep proper. Yukta avabodha, one who awake. So Shankara says, yukto, proper, swapnaha means sleep. Avabodha means waking time. So, niyata kalo, what should be measured? But it differs person to person. Some may be fresh after 7 hours sleep. Some may be fresh after 6 hours sleep. Some may be fresh after 3 hours sleep also. It's called niyata kalo. It can be differ for person to person. Narendra Modi, our Prime Minister, always say he can be fresh within 3 hours sleep. Even 2 hours sleep is good enough for Modi ji. So for him is good enough for 2 hours sleep. But there are people for 8 hours sleep is also not good enough. Even 7 hours. It's called yukta. Our sleep and our waking state should be measured. It's called yukta sapna avabodhasya. For such people who lives, I can say each and every activity should be mindful. Mindfulness activity. This is also, this mindfulness is a Buddha's word. If person follow like this, for such person, yogaha dukkaha bhavati. So Shankaracharya has written, what is the meaning of dukkaha? So he says, sarvani dukkhani. All pain, all types of sorrow, hanti, is destroyed. Iti dukkha. It is called dukkha. And what we can take on as a sorrow and pain, the Shankaracharya says, sansara dukkha. Again, let me clear, the meaning of sansara is not we are a married couple, we are living in our household activity. It's not sansara, but meaning of sansara according to Gita. In our own mind, if we have krodha, if we are disturbed, it's called sansara. So काम क्रोध लोभ मद मोह विच आर अवेलेबल इन अवर माइंड इज कॉल्ड संसार दैट संसार कॉज दुख Nobody can give dukkha to us. Nobody can pain or sorrow to us if we are not ready to take. So, whenever dukkha comes, it never comes from outside. It always comes from inside. And why inside? So we always have some pain inside. That pain, that sorrow, it's called dukkha. That will go. That will destroy. So again, Bhagavan gives the meaning of yoga dukkha bhavati. Then what is the meaning of yoga? Shankaracharya says, the meaning of yoga means self-knowledge. If such person, one who lives a life of proper living, that person can have self-knowledge, and that self-knowledge considered as a yoga, and that self-knowledge remove pain, destroy pain. That's why Shankaracharya has written here, dukkha is not simple dukkha, but here the meaning of dukkha means sansara dukkha kshayakrut. It goes. This is the meaning of yoga. So self-knowledge destroy our sorrow and pain. That's why Narada went to Sanat Kumara in Chandogya Upanishad in 7th chapter and he says, Shochami Bhagavan. He says, I'm very sorrowful. And I heard Atmavit Shokam Tarati. This is a very famous sentence. He says, Atmavit, one who knows oneself, that Shokam Tarati, he crosses this dukkha pain. Same way here, Sansara Dukkham, how it can go, Bhagavan says yoga. So what would be the meaning of yoga here? It says self-knowledge. So self-knowledge, dukkha bhavati. But for which person? Yukta ahara vihara, yukta sapna avabodha, yukta cheshtasya karmasu. For such person, he can have self-knowledge, he or she can have self-knowledge, and that self-knowledge destroy our pain. It destroys our sorrow. Dukkha bhavati. So this is the meaning of yoga dukkha bhavati. This is crucial. Yoga dukkha bhavati. So here, this bahirang sadhana is completed. Now Bhagavan will pick up dhyana swarupa in next verse. We will see in next week. Any question regarding this?
Swaminiji, namaste.
Yes. Namaste.
Swaminiji, here you mentioned Anna. Actually, I wanted me. Anna means actually food, here. Because in South India, Anna means rice. We call rice.
No. Anna means food. We also said Anna means chapati is also Anna.
Regular
food consider as Anna.
Okay.
Yeah. Any question? Yoga dukkha bhavati. No.
There is Swaminiji. There is in I think in Chandogya only where you mentioned there is because you are talking about yukta ahara vihara. I was thinking ahara shuddhau sattva shuddhihi.
Yeah, it comes in. Yeah.
Smriti dhruva or something.
Yeah, smriti dhruva.
Sarva granti nam vipra moksha, something it comes there. So ahara, not only moderation, but also what kind of ahara you take, right? In terms
this
of
this, is mentioned in 17th chapter. Which one is sattvika, one is rajasa, and what is tamasa? Even Chandogya, it comes the subtle portion of annam, what we take, it makes our mind. So that subtle portion of what we are taking food can affect our mind. Even that's why that psychiatric medicine, you know, actually is a sthula, is a gross, but still it affects our mind. So tranquilizer.
Yeah.
So there's a subtle portion. Same way the annam subtle portion can affect our mind. That's why Anna becomes, Annam creates our mind. Our mind depends on which type of food we are taking. It's very
difficult. You can, you can say as you eat, so you become, as you think, so you become.
So you know so that
also is like ahara, right? Like what kind of TV you watch, what kind of music you listen to.
They say ahara for our sense organs. It's all are considered as ahara. What we see, what we listen, what we touch, what we fragrance, what we smell, even what we touch. Everything is ahara. So in every way, it should be yukta. Then only yoga dukkha bhavati. So actually we can say it's a life of discipline.
Yeah.
That's why Ashtanga yoga, you know, is very good. If we follow that Ashtanga yoga, that 8 steps of Patanjali, see next time it will come. Ashtanga yoga, we have already accepted as a practice. We condemn only philosophy of yoga, moksha theory. But we always accept yoga bhyasa. Yoga darshanam means philosophy we never accept. But we always say the yoga bhyasa of Patanjali is the best. This 8 steps, particularly yama niyama, asana pranayam, everything is very good.
Yes, it's good for chitta shuddhi.
Chitta shuddhi, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, here that Mahatma has come for Navratri. He is a Swayampaki. The meaning of Swayampaki, he cooks for himself. So here he says, if you are cooking, I have no problem. But another unknown people, unknown persons, I never eat. Because I don't know what type of thinking is going on in that mind. So it can also. But for sannyasi, it's open to everything. But I think annam is crucial part, what we are taking.
Our Paramacharya used to do Swayampaka,
Okay.
That was Chandrasekhar Saraswati. I think in his younger days, maybe not when he was older, but initially he used to do
Swayampaka.
But also Swaminiji, like if you know, like yat karoshi yadashnasi yat juhoshi dadasi yat tapasyasi kaunteya tat kurushva madarpanam. So even if somebody cooks the food, but you are mindfully, you offer it to Ishvara.
Then yeah, it will be, yeah. We have purified
it. Purified, isn't it? Yeah. I mean, if you are always put in a situation where you have no control, but you have to eat food cooked by others, then you offer to Ishvara and then you take it.
Because being grihastha, you know, all of you, you may have to go to restaurant also.
Yeah.
In meeting also, there you have to go. But if we are, you know, alert, then at that time also we can offer to our Lord. Then we can eat, then it is purified.
Yeah. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, I remember one time, he goes somewhere and one Shudra or untouchable, like he asks water from him and the untouchable says, how can I give water to you? You are a Brahmana, you know. And Ramakrishna Paramahamsa says, it's okay, chant the name of Shiva and you give me the water. And then he says, Om Namah Shivaya, and then gives him water. And then he takes, now this water is pure.
True. So shall we do Purnamada? Om
Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudashyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Guruvyo Namaha. Hari Om.
Thank you.